Hello everyone, welcome to session 9 of Genomic Variant Analysis and Clinical Interpretation Workshop. Today, we are going to understand how to annotate variants using literature-derived attributes. But before we start, let us have a quick revision of the previous session. In our previous sessions, we learned about clinical genomics. When a clinical investigator suspects a patient to have a clinical disease on the basis of symptoms, clinical examination, and family history, he or she collects a sample, sends the sample to the sequencing lab to sequence the genome, analyzes the sequencing result, and finds that an average individual has more than 50,000 variants. Even if he or she decides to narrow down and to look at only few genes, the number of variants would still be in hundreds or thousands. To now determine the causative variant which would be implicated in the suspected disease, one needs to annotate these variants and try to understand its clinical implication. As we understand in the previous week, one globally accepted standard way to do this would be to follow a set of standard guidelines led by the American College of Medical Genetics and Genomics and Association of Molecular Pathology. These guidelines involve a set of 28 attributes which can be assigned on the basis of variant type, allele frequency in different populations, computational predictions to understand the effect of variants, clinical implications by well-annotated databases. A few of these attributes can also be assigned by using literature or scientific publication or articles, such as functional studies around the variant, disaggregation data around the variant, allelic effect of the variant, disease association studies around the variant. Today, we are going to understand how to screen the literature and mine for such evidences and to annotate our variants and classify them as benign or pathogenic. Let us briefly revise what are these attributes. The first set of attributes are based on the interpretations of functional studies. BST is assigned when the variant is found to be pathogenic in functional studies. BST is assigned when the variant is found to be benign in functional studies. The next set of attributes involves interpretations of familial segregations. PP1 is assigned when the variant segregates properly between affected and normal individuals. BS4 is assigned when segregation is not observed. PP4 is assigned when the large family segregation is seen. PS2 is assigned when de novo is confirmed. PM6 is assigned when de novo variant is assumed. The next set of attributes are assigned on the basis of association studies. PS4 is assigned when the odds ratio of the variant and the disease association is greater than 5. BP5 is assigned when the variant is present in healthy individuals. The next set of attributes involves the understanding of allelic effect. When there are two variants and both the variants are present on the same allele, the variant is assigned to be BP2. And when two variants are present on different alleles, PM3 attribute is assigned. So this is a summary of all the attributes that you learned in the previous week. Now let us look at what are the resources that we are going to use for mining relevant publications. These are Google Scholar, PubMed, PMC or PubMed Central, ClinVar and Omen. So let us now one by one look at each one of them. The first one, Google Scholar, is a very simple way to access scholarly articles. It allows fast searching through articles, theses, books, abstracts, and other websites. PubMed also allows fast searching through Medline database of abstracts and references. It is maintained by United States National Library of Medicine. PMC is another database which has freely available full text articles of publications. The next database, that is ClinVar, is an archive of clinically relevant information about variants. It also supports submissions by interested organizations. This is one of the databases which is updated regularly. OMIM is another database which is publicly accessible and has a compendium of human phenotypes and their associations with genes and or variants. There are a few resources which could be very useful while mining relevant publications. One of them is UnpayWall. Many a times when we browse through publications, they are not available freely. In such times, Full text articles can be very useful when we access it through UnpayWall. It can be added as a Chrome extension and it is fully legal. One of the other sites which could be very useful is ResearchGate. It is a social kind of social networking site for scientists and researchers. It allows us to request the author to provide full text article of their published work. What do we need to mine these publications? The first thing that we need is the gene name. Along with that, we need the cDNA change and the position, the protein change and the position, the dbSNP ID or the RSID. What is the basic workflow that we are going to use to mine literature evidences? The first thing that we will use is the VCF file, the same thing that we used in one of the previous lectures. We are going to annotate these variants that are present in the VCF file using VEP, which we used in one of the previous lectures. VEP will provide us with the gene name, the cDNA change and the protein change with coordinates, the dbSNP ID or the RSID. It will also provide us with other details such as global allele frequencies and computational predictions, etc. After this, what we are going to do is we are going to use these things to mine literature evidences. Let us briefly revise few details about the VCF file. As you all know, VCF file has 8 mandatory columns, which are chromosome position, ID, reference base, alternate base, quality score, filter, and info. Out of this, we keep 4 columns as blank and we use only the necessary information, which is the chromosome number, the chromosome position, the reference base, and alternate base. Now we will use this VCF file for further downstream processing. So let us look at the first example. So I processed the file that I just mentioned using VEP and procured the gene name, the cDNA position, the protein change, and the RSID. So let us first try to annotate this variant. So for annotating this variant and mining the literature, I need to use the gene name along with the protein change and the position. So let us begin this search. So firstly, I will use this information to search on Google Scholar. So as you can see, I found about 14 results. So 14 articles have this particular variant. Now I will open the first link. And using the PDF link, I will open the full text of this article. So as you can see in this abstract, the first line itself, there is a line on this particular variant, which says that a kinase assay was performed and the R486 mutation had a normal kinase activity. I'm not able to understand much from this line except for the fact that there is some kind of experimental evidence that I am surely going to retrieve from this particular article. So I will read further. As you can see that this particular variation was introduced into the chicken embryos, limbs of chicken embryos. So there is a particular functional study that is being done in this particular paper. And we will have to read more to understand it completely. So here they are mentioning that the 200K variant and the R486 variant are both present in highly conserved regions of the receptor. So here they are saying that R486W variant was less potent than I200K mutant. So after mining the literature, I understand that this particular variant had two things. So this particular paper had this particular sentence saying that the mildly affected cases presented with BD and severely affected limbs or when this mutant was introduced. So this shows that I can assign the attribute of PS3 for this particular variant. And also I found this sentence in the article that the mutation was present all affected members but in none of the unaffected members. So I can also assign the attribute of PB1. But if I were to assign this attribute, then I would be completely wrong. And why would I be wrong? So if we have a look at this article again and move back to the start, we will see that the gene name that they are mentioning is BMPR1B, whereas we are searching for BMPR1A. Hence, we would be completely wrong in saying, in assigning these attributes to this particular variant. So let us now again read the other publication. So as you can see, none of the publications are really talking about the other variant. So we will open each one of these publications and read them in detail. After I read them in detail, I found out that none of these publications are talking about any of the literature evidences. So I could not assign any of the literature evidences to that particular variant. So let us now use the cDNA change to search for the same evidences. So I found one article which is talking about this particular variant. But this article is a thesis, so I will ignore it. So even for the cDNA change, I could not find any relevant publications. So I cannot assign any of these attributes. So let us now search using the RSID. So as you can see, the search with RSID did not retrieve any articles in Google Scholar, PubMed, or on PMC. So let us now understand what is the information that is given in ClinVar. So ClinVar has classified this variant as a variant of uncertain significance. And they say that this variant has not been reported in any of the literature, which also ascertains the fact that we also did not find any literature associated with that particular variant. Also, we did not find any information on OMIM. So in conclusion, we did not assign any of the literature attributes to this particular variant. So let us now look at the second example. So after annotating the variant with VEP, I got the following gene name, that is LPIN2, the following cDNA change, protein change, and RSID. So let us now first search the gene name along with the protein position. So as you can see, I got a list of 5 articles. So let us open the first one. So as you can see, in the first article, the variant that we are particularly interested in has been cloned. But there is no other detail given. So that is why we will ignore this article. In the next article, they say that they have obtained a clone and the activity assay showed that one type of the mutant has higher phosphatase activity than the wild type. Since this is not a full text article, I will try to obtain the full text of this article. I have installed the unpaywall link, but it is not giving me any source to access this particular article. So the PubMed result does not have any article mined for that particular search. Let me see if that particular paper is there on PubMed. So this particular paper is not there on PubMed. So let me simply search on Google. So this particular paper is not having any associated links. So probably it would be best if I could write to the author and retrieve this particular article in full text links. But as of now, I will annotate the variant as PS3 since I found this particular sentence which said that the activity assay showed that one of the mutants has a higher phosphatase activity than the wild type strain. So for this, I assigned the attribute of PS3. I also went through the other articles and did not find any relevant information. So let us now search using the cDNA change. So I did not retrieve any articles by using the cDNA search. So now what I will do is I will search using the RSID. I will also search ClinVar and OMIM using the RSID. So Google Scholar did not retrieve any articles while using the RSID based search. Even PubMed did not retrieve any articles. Even PMC does not have any articles associated with the RSID. So ClinVar classifies this variant as variant of uncertain significance. So they say that this variant is not reported in medical literature. But we found one article which said that they had cloned the variant. And OMIM also did not retrieve any articles when I searched with the help of RSID. So which means we can only assign the attribute of PS3 to the variant. Now let us finally look at few do's and don'ts that we should follow. Search using all the IDs as discussed, that is the protein change, the cDNA change, and the RSID. Make sure all the publications are related to the variant of interest and the gene of interest. As we saw in the first example, if the publication is not related to the gene of interest or the variant of interest, then the article is particularly of no use to us. The publication should be that we are referring should be associated with the disease of interest. If we are looking at the variant, particularly at a clinical point of view, then we should be very careful when we are reviewing the article. We should particularly keep in mind that the disease that we are looking at and the disease that has been mentioned in the publication is the same. We should also make sure that the clinical consequence is very clearly understood with the help of any functional assay. We should also make sure that the functional assay should be such that the effect should be at least greater than 50% as compared to the wild type. Do not miss details of pedigree in the text. Sometimes the pedigree is not given as a figure but is mentioned in the text format. Do not consider associated studies having an odds ratio of less than 5 and confidence interval should not include 1. These are a few do's and don'ts that you should follow while reviewing the literature-based publication, literature-based attributes. So after this, after we have assigned all the literature-based evidences to our variants, we still are left with some of the other evidences that we are yet to collect. And only after collecting and assigning these attributes, we will be able to say whether our variant is pathogenic or benign. I hope this session has helped you in understanding how to assign literature-based evidences to our variants. We will try to understand this more efficiently in our future sessions. Thank you.